James and Rebecca, a couple living on a small homestead where we are pursuing our higher ideals through living a more natural lifestyle, raising our 6 kids, and seeking wisdom. So, James, what's new with the homestead this week?
Well, today I wanted to talk about our Racken yard. And let me tell you, I've been really looking forward to this one. I was inspired to build my Racken yard by Joel Saladin of Polyface Farm. For those of you who may be unfamiliar with this man, let me give you a quick introduction. Joel Saladin, in addition to being a successful multi-generational farmer, he is also a writer, a lecturer, and an outspoken homestead celebrity. Finding him on YouTube, I was instantly drawn to his creative farming practices and boundless enthusiasm. He is a committed environmentalist in the truest and most positive sense of the word. Joel is one of those few men who lives out his ideals and embodies authenticity. If you are becoming more interested in homesteading and you have yet to encounter Joel Saladin, I highly recommend looking him up. A Racken yard is a space where rabbits and chickens live together in a symbiotic microenvironment. The ground is covered in a deep bed of mulch, and on top of the mulch are chickens, and above the chickens are rabbits, which are usually housed in an elevated rabbit hutch of some kind. In our specific case, we have 2 dozen chickens in our Racken yard, and the rabbits live in a rabbit house suspended from oak trees. Our rabbit house consists of 6 separate cages, 4 cages for our 2 breeding pairs, and 2 larger grow-out cages for their kits. Now, placing the Racken yard among the oak trees was not my idea. When we moved to the property, the prior owner walked us around and told us about his pigs. He had raised a pair of pigs right up against the barn, and there were plans to raise more pigs among the oaks. In fact, the posts had already been set, and the fencing material was in the barn, ready to go. A few weeks later, after finally getting settled in our new home, I'm out trimming some of the trees, clearing some brush, you know, cleaning up and getting to know the place a little bit. As I'm trimming the oaks, I'm talking to them. "Hey, I'm not here to hurt you. I'm not cutting you down. We're just cleaning you up a little bit." And I tell the trees how happy my family and I are to be there and all the plans we have. And I start to tell the trees about the plans there were to raise pigs there and how I wanted pigs. And then I stop and I put down the saw and I place my hand on the trunk of the tree and I start asking the oaks if they want some pigs. I mean, I want pigs. Pigs would be great. And maybe the trees would want pigs too, you know, tilling up the soil, adding their manures. But if they'd prefer something different, they ought to let me know. You see, I was raised to believe that the land, the trees, the water, our house, the hearth, they all have a spirit, and they all deserve acknowledgement, respect, and consideration. Now, I had no expectation that the oaks were going to verbally answer my questions. Yet within about 5 minutes of me asking, the idea of a rabbit house popped into my head. I gotta tell you, I've never seen anything like a rabbit house suspended from trees, so I know this wasn't my idea. The idea came from the oaks, and they told me to call my rabbits treehouse rabbits, which is a name I absolutely love. It took me a little over a year to bring this idea into reality, but I think the oaks are happy that I did, and we are so happy to have our treehouse rabbits. So what does a farmer get from a Racken yard? Well, you get eggs, chicken meat, rabbit hides, and compost. This area of our homestead is so bountiful because there are 3 levels of production: the compost level, the chicken level, and the rabbit level. The compost level, level 1, is vital. If there are going to be a lot of animals in one area, there must be a plan to balance out and manage all their manure. And manure management starts with a thick layer of mulch. Thick, not like flower garden thick, more like over a foot deep. Rabbits and chickens all deposit their manures onto the mulch and the dry wood chips soak it up. So now you have carbon from the mulch and nitrogen from the manures mixing together and breaking down into a rich compost for your garden. And what's more, there's no stink. Bad farm smells indicate a loss of balance. These smells are usually caused by excess nitrogen evaporating away. If you smell manures, you're losing valuable nitrogen and you need to add some carbon, i.e. another layer of mulch. Now, as a quick aside, when we bought our rabbits, we picked them up from a breeder on the other side of town. They had what looked like such a beautiful setup. Their rabbitry was built among their garden. And it was beautiful, from a distance. But when you got up close, all you could smell was rabbit manure, and there were flies everywhere. Carbon-rich deep bedding eliminates bad farm smells and reduces the opportunities for flies to lay their eggs. Chickens are another layer of protection against flies, as they are excellent hunters. For anyone struggling with excess animal waste, adding a composting process is a game changer. The chicken level 2 is pretty self-explanatory. We could probably double the number of chickens in our racken yard, but we don't need that many eggs. And as you all know, chickens love to scratch, and I love seeing how hard my chickens work to turn the compost as they scratch. The rabbit level 3, in my opinion, is the most fun. We raise tamic rabbits, as they are bred to tolerate our heat. They're a meat rabbit known for being excellent mothers and having lots of kits. The kits are ready to harvest in about 8 to 12 weeks, and harvesting rabbits is about as easy as harvesting chickens. Okay, well that's it for the racken yard. If you're interested in raising chickens and you're interested in raising rabbits, I would highly recommend this setup. And with that, I'd like to know what's new with homeschooling.
We have two approaches to geography in our homeschool. We use stories, often regional books or travel stories, to build connections with locations, and we do map work once a week. In the past, map work has included what are called continent blobs, where the kids draw the rough shape of each continent in the rough location and label them. It's included labeling states or labeling countries. This year, we have been focused on geographical features. We've done the oceans, major rivers, major mountain ranges, major deserts, and other significant features, such as the Amazonian rainforest and the Mediterranean Sea. For history this year, we are focused on Rome. We've made it to the Punic Wars, and this week Hannibal of Carthage attacked Rome before being called home to defend against Scipio. It was neat because when we read about Hannibal invading Italy from the north, the kids understood that this would entail going through the Alps, since they'd been adding the Alps to maps for months. When Hannibal sailed across the Mediterranean Sea from Italy back to Africa, that too had meaning because of the map work they'd been doing. It felt like he sailed through a location we were already familiar with. History and geography are intimately intertwined, and this week, that relationship gave each subject added significance and depth of understanding.
That sounds really interesting. With that, do you want to introduce today's discussion topic?
Sure. This week, we wanted to discuss the importance of allowing children to be bored. Our society has reached a place where we're almost afraid to let children get bored. There's different reasons for this. It can be really difficult on a parent. Most kids are naturally good naggers, at least mine are. They want easy entertainment and will whine and complain and wheedle to get it. And they can seem to scent vulnerability when you need them to just give you half an hour to get this project finished, to make this phone call or place this order. And after you've given in once, they will use that like a cudgel against you. But filling kids' time isn't always from a place of negativity. There are so many amazing educational opportunities, cultural experiences, enrichment activities. And we don't want our kids to miss out. When I look at all the various lessons, sports teams, field trips they could be doing, and compare those with what my kids are actually doing most of the time, playing with dolls, making up songs, climbing trees, it doesn't feel as productive, as intellectually stimulating, as beneficial toward their long-term success. And yet, having that downtime is vital. Emotionally, psychologically, spiritually, and yes, intellectually. They need time to process information and personal experiences. They need freedom in which to explore interests. It's when we're bored that we're forced to develop creativity, coming up with something to do. It's when we have the opportunity to do the things we love that we develop attention spans and go into that flow state. And it's in exploring all of these different aspects of where our interests lie and don't lie that we start to really figure out who we are.
You know, when I think back to my own childhood, I remember the plague of boredom and the lengths I would go to cure myself. Some of these lengths were not so healthy, like watching a bunch of TV or playing video games. Yet most of the time, I would get outside. I'd go see what my friends were doing. We'd usually end up riding bikes up and down the big hill, catching frogs near the creek, or we'd go tromping through the woods on some made-up adventure. I'd usually be seeking some sort of treasure while my friend would be an alien visiting from another planet. You know, none of these stories made much sense, but I gotta tell you, they were all day kind of fun. As a child, boredom became an indicator that I needed to get up and go find something to do, but it didn't start that way. And that's not how I see boredom today. Yet before we get into that, I think it's important that we define what boredom is. The simplistic idea of boredom is not having anything to do. But this doesn't really capture it. I don't know about you, but I found myself being bored while doing things. Just about anybody who's held an entry-level job anywhere can remember feeling bored at work. With this in mind, I think a better definition would be not wanting to do any of the things available for you to do. It's this restlessness of wanting something fun and engaging that is offset perfectly and coupled with a complete lack of motivation to really do anything. So with this as our working definition of boredom, why would we want our children to experience this? Well, one of the reasons is that a child who never experiences boredom is trapped in the now. They will constantly be shifting from one point of focus to another, receiving all sorts of visual, audio, and tactile stimuli. The child will transition from one activity to the next without any time to evaluate what they just experienced. By giving our children the gift of boredom, we allow their minds to develop and grow. Their thoughts will wander. They may think of something that happened earlier in the day or something they want sometime in the future. And one of the neatest things that happens is that the child will start to develop their inner voice. Having retreated into their own heads, creative play ensues. Stuffed animals and action figures become characters enthralled in some drama playing out in your child's head. Sometimes I catch one of my girls carrying on a conversation between 3 and 4 different characters. Teddy, Lion, Piglet, and Army Man all discussing what should happen to the evil monster who stole the magical amulet. And this is really cool stuff, as this is really complex dialogue. It's also emotional experimentation, as some of the characters are scared or angry or even indifferent. It's this kind of creative play, born from a state of boredom, that is your child's moral imagination hard at work. So while being bored is great for childhood development, boredom also plays a significant role in my day. When doing many of my homestead chores, I purposely choose to do this work in silence in order to have time to think. And it works out really well, as my chores have become a routine, and I can do most of the tasks with little or no thought, so it's naturally boring. And yet, the state of boredom has a way of fueling my creativity. This is when I imagine having other animals on the farm, or developing new process of taking care of animals I already have in a more efficient manner. This is when I plan the rest of my day. It's when I think of conversations I've had with Rebecca and new ideas I want to share with her. It's also a time for self-evaluation. I use this time to do a quick self-check-in. I ask myself, am I putting my time, attention, and resources towards that which I value most? Or another way of saying it, are my beliefs and my actions one and the same? So yes, it is important to allow our kids to be bored. Boredom spurs creativity, allows escape from the now, helps develop the inner voice, and creates a space for self-evaluation. These are all things we want for our children, as this helps kids become their best selves.
I'll tell you where I really struggle as a parent is finding the right balance. Because we're definitely not saying there should only be free time, that opportunity for boredom, and none of those enriching activities. If only it was so simple. We want there to be that answer. What's best for our kids to be an unequivocal this in all circumstances. Boredom is good for kids, therefore more boredom is better. But we absolutely have structured activities. School lessons, extracurriculars, family outings. Things we've talked about on this podcast. The question is, where is the right balance? The golden mean? Nothing in excess. This is my struggle, because I can't really know. Different kids have different needs, and these needs change over time. And what I'm capable of providing fluctuates. We're in a stage of life with a baby, a toddler, and a preschooler. So providing a lot of structure for my older kids is not just hard, but not always possible. So I do the best I can, and that line ebbs and flows. I find it really comforting that structured and unstructured time both have value. So there is a pretty wide range of what I consider imbalance for our family. But when we've had too many outings in a row, I start to crave some downtime. And when we've been on a break for a while, I really start looking forward to restarting school. Because we homeschool, I'm living that structure with them, so I'm very attuned to how much structure my kids are experiencing.
Well, that wraps it up for this week. Until next week, we'll keep taking the next step in our pursuit of our higher ideals and hope you're encouraged to take the next step towards yours.